Hi everyone, I am Prasanna, who is an Associate Technical Lead at WSO2, accompanied with Mustaq Rumi, who is a Senior Software Engineer, doing this webinar for you today. Our topic for the webinar is API Manager 101, a Developer Experience with WSO2. We will be conducting the webinar with an example for you to get a better understanding. Let's move on. So first of all, what's the client-server communication? Let's go with an example. Let's take a simple example. An airline exposes their microservices directly for internal and external applications, and there is an internal application that uses the data. Let's call the airline as AIABC and the application as Flight Information System. So it will be a simple client-server communication where AIABC exposes daily flight information and Flight Information System uses them. While this communication is happening smoothly, there will be external parties trying to access this data. Flight Information System might be using the service in a high frequency. Then the service provider, who is the AIABC, will face some problems such as: how to secure the service? How to monitor the service invocations? How do you limit the service invocations? How to restrict the API for external parties, and so on? So what would be the solution for this? Okay, so if we can introduce a layer that wrap up the service and facilitate this controlling stuff, monitoring stuff, and governing stuff, that will be the solution for this. So let's say we can wrap up the service, and that's and that layer that wraps up will guarantee the security, control, and monitor the things and govern the stuff. And that layer, we call it as an API, which is an application programming interface. Application programming interface lies between the client application and the service. The client application communicates to the API, and the API communicates to the service and feed the data to the client application. So while this is happening, this service might be accessing from many applications, and many applications may using many services. So it will be a many-to-many relationship between client applications and services. So while we have many-to-many relationships, we should have many API layers in between them. So when it comes to a practical real-world example, we have to manage these middle layers called APIs. How do we can manage these APIs? To manage these APIs, we need to have API management solutions. Let's see what an API management solutions can offer. API management solutions can govern the system and control the system. As you can see in the diagram, this API management solution will be the interface for web applications, mobile applications, and many more. It has the capability to access services, cloud resources to facilitate API calls, which we named as API invocations previously in a client-server communication. It will be the layer that handles authentication, authorization, limiting API calls frequencies. Further, the API management solutions offers dashboards for monitoring stuff, analytical purposes. API governance include API lifecycle management as well. I'll explain about API lifecycles in the following slide. Now we'll discuss how this service is wrapped on an API is introduced. So someone might be thinking, how can an application developer, which is the flight information system, can get data? Okay, so there should be a place to develop the application. I mean the API, develop the API. So when you develop an API, and you have to publish and deploy into a place where the application developer can access the API, that place is called the gateway. Once you've deployed it to the gateway, the third-party application or the external internal application can access the gateway and get the data from the service. So I'll be moving to a demo and show how this application development can be done using WSO2 API Manager 3.0.0, which was released previously. So for the demonstration purpose, I have three users created in WSO2 API Manager 3.0.0. One is John. John is an API developer. One is Smith. Smith is an internal application developer for ARABC, as for the example. And one is Terry. Terry is an external application developer. So let's move on to the API publisher. Right, I have logged in as John. So what I'll do is I'm going to create a new API. You can create using new APIs using SOAP endpoints, GraphQL schema, WebSocket APIs, and REST APIs. For the demonstration purposes, I'll move on with REST APIs. When you go to the REST API screen, first thing, of course, you need to give is the API, a name for the API. I'll give it as Flight Information System API. Flight Information API. I'll give the context as flight info. Since this is my first API, I'll give the version as 1.0.0. Let me speak a few words about the endpoint. This is the endpoint of the service which the API layer communicates. For the demonstration purposes, we have a mock endpoint configured, and that is running in our 3.0.0.5 port. And since I type this, I can validate whether this endpoint is working or not by clicking is this tick. So it's okay. So this is the business plan. Business plan is the limitation that you can allow the users to access this API. For the moment, we can select multiple business plans. What I'll do is I'll select two out of them. And let me speak a few words about these two buttons, right? Let's imagine that you have a microservice as an endpoint. So if you have a microservice as an endpoint, you can directly deploy it to the gateway using this create and publish button. But for the demonstration purpose, I'll push the create button and show you all the details. Right. So when you do a create button, this is the new API Manager 3.0.0 publisher UI, and you can see the endpoint that you specified, and the API is in created state. So what is the created state? Created state is the state that you can develop the API, and once the development is done, you can publish it to the gateway. Then only the consumers can consume the APIs. The consumer part will be explained by my colleague Mustaq in future. I'll go through the tabs and explain what are those things. So as I said earlier, this is an internal application. So I need to restrict the API only for the internal applications. So as I mentioned earlier, I have three users. Smith is an internal application developer. So I want to restrict this API for Smith. So what I'll do is I'll go to the design configurations and I'll select the developer. I'll select the restrictions as restricted by rows. So I have a role that assigned to Smith as internal developer. I named it as int_dev. So what I'll do is once I save this, this API will be restricted only for internal developers, right? So what does that mean? So as I mentioned earlier, when you do the development stuff, you have to publish this API to the gateway. So when you're going to publish, before publishing, you have to add resources for the APIs, right? So I'm going to the resources tab. As in the default, all the star resources are there. So what I have to do is I have to add what are the resources that I need and remove the star resources from here. So as this is a flight information system, I'm adding a get resource to get all the flights information. And I'm adding another get resource to add a specific flight get information. For that, of course, I have to add the flight ID as a parameter. So I have two get resources, and I am adding another post resource to add flight information. So I'll be removing all the unwanted stuff. And saving it. Right. Now, as a summary, we have the flight information API, and that API has two get resources, flights. First one to get all the flight details, and the second one to get a specific flight detail, and third one to add flights. Right. I'm going to show you the endpoints as well. And again, as I mentioned in the earlier slide about the lifecycle. One, now I'm in the creating state of this API. Now the API is created state, and any of the API consumers or its consumers can't access this API because it's still in the creator state. So what I need to do is I need to publish it and change the state to published. So once I published it, it will be deployed to the gateway. So what I'm doing is I'm going to publish the API. Right. So once I have published API, again, I'm going to the overview screen and showing you that the API state is published. Right. Now what we can do now, let's say, let's go to back to the previous example where flight information system is going to use this flight information API. So that flight information system user comes to the developer portal of API Manager WSO2 300. So now I'm going to the developer portal of WSO2 API Manager 300. Right. So this is the developer portal. As I mentioned earlier, the API is restricted for internal developers. And I mentioned that Terry is an external developer. Let's see how what happens if Terry logs in. Once the Terry is logged in, he can't see any of the APIs because it's restricted for only for internal developers. Now what I'm doing is I'm going to log in from the internal developer, who is Smith. Right. So the Smith can see the API in the developer portal. So Smith can access details and so on. So one important aspect that Smith is searching is where is the documentation for this API, right? So at the moment I haven't added any documentations, right? But we can add documentations for an API, and for that, of course, it should be the API developer. So now I'm going to switch for John and going to add a documentation. I can do that using the document step, and I'll name this as document one. So this document contains information related flight information system. Flight information API. So I am adding a markdown API documentation. So what I'll do is I'll add the content. I have the content here saved with me. Okay, so once you add the documentation is displayed in the dev portal. So let me go to the dev portal and show you. So once I go to the dev portal, the added documentation is showed here. So the developer, I mean the application developer, can see the documentation and program whatever the application asks for this documentation. Right. So now let's think about a scenario like this. We have an API that has three resources. Let me go to the resources tab. Three resources. Get two get resources and one post resource. And since Smith is an internal developer, he can use the post resource as well to add flights. So let's imagine we want to expose only the flight information and only two of these resources to an external party. One of the main components that we have introduced in API Manager 3.0.0 is API product. I'll give you a brief introduction about API product. In API product, we can bundle APIs using selected resources of APIs. We have a set of webinars that coming up using depth knowledge of API product. For the moment, I'll only select these two get resources and create a product for the external developers to use it. So I'm going to create an API product. So as I mentioned earlier, the business plans will be the same. And I'm going to create the product. This is the new UI that we can drag and drop the resources that we need to select. So I am going to select the get resources to the API product and publish it. So when I go to the UI, I have an API product and I have an API. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to the developer portal and show you what's there. So as I said earlier, I have logged in as Smith. So Smith is an internal developer. So Smith should see both of the API product and the APIs. So when I go to the APIs, he can see the API product as well as the APIs. So let's say I'm going to log out and see what will be the result. So since this API product is public and it's for external users, it will be displayed here, right? Even when the Terry signs in, it's displayed because Terry is also an external user. Okay. Yeah, I spoke about the documentation purpose. So the consuming of the API part, my colleague Mustaq Rumi will continue the presentation.
Thank you, Prasanna. So I'll be taking you through starting from consuming an API. Okay, so consuming an API will be important to all the application developers who are looking for services or APIs which gives data to implement their application. For example, an application developer who is trying to implement a web application to get the flights and particular flight details for AIABC, he or she needs to consume an API which is exposed by AIABC with the relevant data. If we take a look at how the application developer can make use of an API published, first, the application developer needs to register the application in the developer portal, subscribe to the API they need to use, generate keys, and then start using the API. As we already have an API called Flight Information API published by AIABC, let's have a look at how the internal application developers at AIABC and external application developers can register their applications and subscribe to the relevant APIs. We will demonstrate this using the developer portal of WSO2's API Manager. Okay, for the demonstration purpose, what I'll do is I'll be signing in as Smith, who is an internal application developer. And let's assume that Smith needs to subscribe to the Flight Information API. First, he needs to register his application. So what Smith needs to do is go to the overview page of the Flight Information API and click on this subscribe to an API application. So this screen has an option to subscribe to this API with a new application. So I'll go with that option in order to register my new application. So I'll name the application as Flight Information App. And you can always select the token type. We have auth and JWT. So for the moment, I'll select JWT, and I'll be giving the description as flight information application. So once you click next, it will be prompted for you to subscribe to the new application for this particular API. So you can select your throttling policy. So I'll select it as unlimited for the moment and click on next. Once you click next, you will get the option to generate the keys for this particular application. So I'll click on next, and then you will get the page where you will be able to generate the access token for this application so that you can consume the API resources using this access token. So in this screen, you can see that the access token is successfully generated. So for the moment, I'll copy this access token so that we can use in the next tab to invoke or consume the API. So as you can see, the flight information system has get post, to get resources and post resources. So first, let's try to invoke. Let's try to invoke the get resource, which is flights, which will give you all the available flights. And as you can see, the backend responded with the set of available flights as a JSON object. So if you want to get a detailed flight response from the backend by giving the flight ID, so what we can do is we can try to execute or invoke the get resource. Yeah, we can try to execute the get resource by giving the flight ID. So as you can see, the backend responded with a JSON object with that particular flight ID given in the input parameter. So this is the basic idea on how we can consume an API using the developer portal of API Manager. So let's move on with the slides. Okay, next we will look at why versioning is important. Versioning is important when there are new changes or new features are introduced to the existing service. For example, an API developer who wants to add a new resource or resources to the same API can introduce a new version of the same API. Let's take a look at how we can achieve this in the demo. Let's have a look at how an API developer at AIABC can version their APIs. We will introduce a new version of Flight Information API by including a new resource. Okay. So let's go to the publisher. And so we have already logged in as John, who is the API developer. So what we need to do is we need to create a new version of this particular API. So from at the top right corner, you can see an icon called Create New Version. So you can click on that and give the version as 2.0.4.
It's 11 o'clock.
As this is the new version. So you can see that Flight Information API has been created with a new version, which is 2.0.0. So now let's add a new resource to this new version API. So we will add a put resource so that the users of this API can give the flight ID and update the flight details. So let's add the resource and save the API. So in order for this to be available on the developer portal, As Prasanna mentioned earlier, we need to publish this API to the gateways. So we have two different checkboxes, as you can see. One, you can deprecate the older versions after publishing the new version of the API. The other one is to, if you want the subscribers of the APIs to resubscribe to this new API. So for now, I'm not going to select any of those. I'll just publish the API. And if you go to the developer portal, as you can see, the newly versioned API, Flight Information API, which is version 2.0.0, is available in the developer portal. So someone might wonder why the other versioned API is not available in the developer portal. WSO2 API Manager allows you to configure if you want to have display multiple versions in the developer portal. So by default, it is set to false. So if you want, you can always enable it. Okay, let's move on with the slides. So next comes another important topic, which is monitoring APIs and API calls. Why monitoring APIs are important? Monitoring is important when you need to monitor in terms of business insights. When we talk about monitoring, the API developer and application developer should be able to view statistics like most popular subscribers, number of API invocations, and so on. They also should be able to detect fraud and send alerts accordingly. Now let's have a look at how we can monitor APIs and the invocations made to it using WSO2's API Manager Analytics component. Here we see how the API developer, in our example, it's John, and the application developer, Smith, can view the analytics data using the WSO2's API Manager Analytics. Let's log into the analytics dashboard of WSO2's API Manager. So first, I'll be logging in to the dashboard using John's credentials, who is an API developer. So since John is an API developer, only the API publisher dashboard will be available. So once you click on that, the statistics will be populated, and you can see the overview of the statistics in the whole overview page. If John wants to see the usage summary of his API, he can go to this usage summary tab, and he can see the number of hits that his API has got. So in our case, the API information, the flight information API has got 2 hits. Now let's try to log in as an application developer to the analytics dashboard. In our case, it's Smith, who is an application developer at AIABC. And as you can see, since Smith is an application developer, the APM developer portal dashboard will be visible for him. He also can see the resource usage of his application. And if we see the API name is displayed here with the version and the resource, and also its hits count. So likewise, there are various other statistics available in the developer portal and APIM publisher dashboard as well. So now let's have a look at another very important concept called CI/CD. So continuous integration and continuous development. So if we take an organization, it can have multiple environments, such as development, testing, QA, staging, and production, each with its own instance of API managers. These environments often have different configurations for APIs. And when an API changes, these changes should be reflected in other environments with configurations. These migrations are often done manually and are error-prone. For example, at AIABC, they have multiple environments, namely dev, QA, pre-prod, and prod. At the moment, they are using manual API migration between these environments. This is where CI/CD comes into play. The CI/CD process makes a developer's life easier by providing an automated mechanism to run tests and build upon a central code base, eliminating most issues in a developer cycle. As shown in the above diagram, the CI/CD pipeline should be able to be integrated with any existing version control system and to support any available CI/CD automation server. This should be able to be flexible and provide maximum productivity for developers. We will talk on building CI/CD pipeline in depth in the upcoming webinars. But for now, we will take a look at a simple example on how we can achieve this in the demo. Let's have a look at how AIABC can use CI/CD to automate their API migration between each environment. We will do a demo using WSO2 API Manager's latest CLI tool, where it will export an API from dev environment and import it to prod environment with the endpoint URL changed to prod. So let's take a look at the demo of CLI. So if you go to the publisher or the API developer portal, so John is already logged in to the API developer portal or the publisher. And you can see in the overview section, the production and sandbox endpoint URL is mentioned as dev.aiabc.com. So when we export and import this to the production environment, this needs to be changed to prod.aiabc.com. So let's take a look at how, first let's take a look at how we can export the API from the dev environment. So for the demonstration purpose, I have the command already copied. So this is the particular command that we need to give using the API Manager CLI tool. So our flight information API is a API. And the version is 1.0.0, and the provider is John. So let's export this API. So as you can see, the API is exported successfully, and it will be exported as a zip named as flight information API underscore 1.0.0. If you take a look at the production environment, there are no APIs at the moment. So let's import the exported API, which is the flight information API. And this is the command to import the API. So we will have to give the exported environment and the file name, which is flight information API underscore 1.0.0.zip. And we need to give the environment where we need to import this particular API. So let's import this API. So as you can see the message, it says successfully imported the API. And if we go to the prod environments publisher, and if you go to the overview section, you can see that the production and sandbox endpoint URL has been changed to prod.aiabc.com. So you may be thinking that how we can achieve this endpoint URL change. So we have a file called API Parents YAML where you need to configure these environments and the endpoint URLs related to those environments. So these configurations will be covered in detail in the upcoming webinar of CLI. So these are the basic things that we needed to cover in this particular webinar. So we are open for any questions you may ask if you have.
Hi, yes, we have some questions coming up. So the first question came to us is, can we generate resources by importing an Open API 3 specification? Yes, of course we can do. We have to go to the API developer, API publisher. And when you are going to create, when you are going to create an API, we have to select existing REST API endpoint. And you can select the Open API URL or Open API 3 URL or the file and do the import.
So we have another question which asks whether the migration from WSO2 version 2 to version 3 is a replacement or an upgrade. So it's basically an upgrade of V2, but we have a revamped UI which is based on React. So, and we have also introduced new features such as GraphQL, API product, and API monetization.
We have another question that when API is published, where does it get published? Actually, it publishes to the gateway. From the gateway, of course, as we explained in the webinar, the consumers can consume the APIs.
Okay, so those are the questions that we have got. So we will have these upcoming webinars so that you can register for these webinars as well. So I think we can wrap up this webinar from this.
And thanks for all the guys who joined the webinar. And hope you guys join for other webinars as well.
Hope this webinar was very useful for you. Thank you.
And these webinars will be displayed in our WSO2 site. So for you to get a brief understanding, this is the schedule that is scheduled for the upcoming webinars.